I love that song. Today we are talking about patience, so it's a perfect song for that, you know. I allow. You know, one thing that I hear a lot, and I'm sure Judy does too, when we're talking to people here at Common Ground is that, you know, they're going through some stuff in their life and they just can't understand why they can't get through it faster, right? You know, I should be someplace other than where I am at. You know, I'm a spiritual person. I ought to be, you know, a lot more there by now. And I remember at a time that was really difficult in my life, that I remember thinking that same thing. It was so dramatic for me that I remember knowing I would get through this. You know, I'd finally get to the other side. But boy, you know, I just wanted to get there. I wanted to be healed and I wanted it now. And it just doesn't work that way. You know, it just doesn't work that way. You know, healing right in the moment. See, patience is a struggle for all of us. You know, I remember people, my mom used to say, "This too shall pass." I hated that. I say it, I be careful I don't say it to my kids a lot too, but you know, it's absolutely true. This too shall pass. And it's just you'd be careful when you say it to people, right? You know. So you know, I wanted my healing now and it just wasn't happening. I wasn't able to heal until I was patient with myself and my feelings for wanting to heal. Does that make sense? All the emotions that you have for healing. It was only when I let the feelings, you know, be that I was able to begin, you know, the time frame of healing for me. It's only when I created the space for my soul was I able to heal it all. And that's allowing it. When we create the space, we allow it. We allow the pain to be. And then we let the soul transform it. See? We don't do it ourselves. We let our soul do the work for us. But we have to create the space. See, if my soul has the space, the divine can work wonders with it. You know, so this talk is going to be focused for me on practicing patience through creating a soul space for us. See, and I really got that so last week, and I thought it was perfect because it's Earth Day, and I've been thinking so much and reading so much about this incredible, beautiful Earth that we have. So I wake up every morning, and that's part of my practice, but I happen to get up really early, and I open my drapes, and it's so pretty out there, and, you know, it's just starting, and the sun is starting to come up, and, you know, I'm kind of in between, you know, waking up and sleeping. You know, you kind of get in that dream world, you're right in between where, you know, there was this welcome slowness to my mind. Hasn't really kicked in yet. I don't get that a lot, you know, but I had it in the morning. So I'm just sitting in my couch, and all of a sudden I hear this incredible, I guess it's a bird song is all I can think about it. The birds were starting to come out. And there was like a crow, you know, going, bah, bah, bah. And there was this little other bird, and it's almost like they were in this rhythm, this song. You know, it took me to this whole different place. It was the most incredible thing that I've ever seen in my life, that it was like I wish I could just tape it and have you guys hear, because it was like this music to my ear, and I loved it. There's a little waterfall in the background, and I was in a different place. And I noticed that as I'm sitting there, my heart is starting to get into sync with the music. Okay, there's the pulse, right? The pulse goes, you know, slower, and it starts to be in coherence kind of with nature out there. And it was so beautiful. I'm having this mystical experience, you know. And then all of a sudden, the alarm goes off upstairs, and I live, you know, my kids all have a bedroom upstairs, and I hear, and all this stuff, you know, the alarm's going off, and it's going, "Get ready for school, we have a field trip," you know, and all of this other stuff is going on. So, and I got to thinking, now this is interesting, because here I am in this, like, world, you know, this, you know, peaceful world, and then there's the human, right, this human element, you know, comes in, and I'm thinking, that's what we do, you know, we live kind of both, we live, don't we, with the human element, and then we have this other place that we are, and so my heart started to race a little bit faster, and then I said, okay, I'm ready for my day. But I've got my peace. I have a soul space that I can kind of take with me and meet the world. So what this kind of told me is that we're all yearning. Boy, I'll tell you, I really believe this is the challenge that we all have. We're yearning to get back to our wholeness. And our wholeness includes this element of nature, this element of the earth, the beat of the earth, You know, we yearn for that. I believe that that's what we've lost, that we've lost our connection to our home, because that's where we're from. We really are. We really are from the earth. You know, it's like we are yearning for our roots, for our mother. And we go about our day and we completely forget to get centered, to get, you know, rooted in the earth. You know, there was a time that we were deeply connected to the earth. And through the many thousands of years, you know, we grew through to who we are today. But our natural pace is still in our cells and our bodies. And our natural pace is really peaceful. And it's not to be impatient and rushed. It's to be the slowness of the earth, you know? So it wasn't that long ago that the rest of the animals and the plants and us all lived on earth together. We moved through our natural cycles, not the unnatural cycles that we have today. Time was marked at that time by the passing of the seasons. By the passing of the seasons. The life cycle of humans and animals and plant life were all the same. And we lived that way for thousands of years until the Industrial Revolution happened. You know, and then all of a sudden, we started to get machine time, right? Machine time. So our brains had to switch. Not a bad thing. It's just that we didn't know exactly how to switch over to machine time. So the rise of the machine changed everything. And now it's the rise of the internet. So, wow, the world's really fast. If I want information, I can get it like this, right? I looked up some stuff on Google, you know, and it's like, I have it just like this. You have everything. Everything is changing. So, so I think what happens is that unless we have shifted back and are grounded in that sacred space, that we get wrapped up in this time and we're out of sync with who we are. You know, we're impatient with everything. Like I said, we want it and we want it now. You know, we don't want to wait in line at the bank. We don't want to, this poor little lady was writing a check in line the other day. You don't write checks in grocery stores anymore because it takes too much time. You know, you swipe your card, and if you don't know how, it's like everybody behind you is mad. You know? Isn't that true? Have you experienced that before? Same thing with ATM machines. Everything is so quickly. Everything is done so quickly. There's a comedian. I have to laugh because I saw him probably 5 years ago when I was doing this talk. I was thinking about it. But he's got this routine. It's called, everything is amazing and nobody's happy. And then he has this little segment. And I remember this. I tried to find it, and I actually did find the clip of it. But I don't have time to show it. But it was so cute because he was talking about some kid has a cell phone, and kid doesn't know anything about old time like he did. You know, he knew the times of the rivers and all this stuff. But anyway, so he's got this cell phone, and the kid's going, you know, trying to get to the internet. He goes, like that. And then the guy goes, you know, give it a minute. It's going to space. You know. About that. You know, think about your own cell phone. You're putting in to get an answer, it's going to space and back, and yet you're mad because it hasn't gone back to space yet. I mean, that's how we're living. And so our heart races, you know, we try to keep up with everything, and our expectations start to get higher and higher because it shouldn't take 2 minutes, you know, it should take 10 seconds. You know, 2 minutes, heck, you'd throw down your phone if it took that long. But our expectation is higher and our appreciation is lower. You know, I really do believe that. So we struggle as a species ourselves to adapt to the strange mechanical world that we have created, right? We've created this. See, everything is speeded up now, and we're trying to catch up. And that's why I think that we're so impatient with everything. There's actually a condition, you know, along with ADD and stuff called time poverty. Time poverty, you know, yeah. And it's a recognized psychological social stressor. In a speeded up, highly complex society, there just isn't enough time for everything. There isn't enough time for what we have to do. Here's what I know. You know, when we feel the need to speed up, and I do that all the time, we gotta slow down. Right? You get what I'm saying? When we feel the need, like we have to hurry, boy, that's when we need to slow down or we get what Judy says, stupid. We get stupid. Our brains don't work right. We have to learn how to slow down. There's a famous quote, and I love it, and it says that it's imperative to meditate a half hour every day unless you are busy. And then it's necessary to meditate an hour. Have you heard that? What that means is we gotta slow down, guys. We gotta slow down, and I speak to myself when I speak of this. You know, it's time for us to feel our roots, you know, to get back to being able to get centered in where we came from, you know, in this beautiful earth. You know, we're just too busy to be patient, you know, we're just too busy, and it's time for us to really look at that. So I started doing some research on, this was an incredible experience I had just sitting there. I don't know, I couldn't really explain the mystical experience it was to be able to sit in my room and feel that nature. It was like an aha moment for me. So I started to read about it, and I've heard people, Stacy, when you were kind of stressed out, and went to the beach and you said, oh, you know, I felt so good. And you hear it all the time when people are stressed out, that's what they do. See, nature is a healer. So I started to look it up, and I started to read all of this stuff, and I found out in the 90s, there was a group of scholars and activists who got together, and they were discussing nature, the way that nature works with these healing practices. And they founded these terms of ecotherapy and eco-psychology. You know, what it means is it's just a new form of psychotherapy that acknowledges the role of nature. You know, it's green therapy. You've heard of green therapy. It's the same thing. Because we suffer from major deficit disorder, NDD. See, you think you suffer from ADD, you know, that's attention deficit, but you suffer from major deficit disorder. And so this is what they found out. They've done all these incredible studies. And this is really cool. Being outside in nature has the same effect as antidepressants. 20 minutes. 20 minutes. I'm not saying don't take your antidepressants. Please don't hear me say that. I'm just saying that 20 minutes sitting outside, you know, feeling the sun. Actually, even the study said that if you look at pictures, you don't even have to be out there. You can look at a picture and it does the same thing. It's incredible how we can heal ourselves. They said that it's a cure for depression, mental health, you know, mental health. It's now proving that reconnecting with nature and natural living lowers your depression, improves our sense of well-being, calms anxieties, raises your self-esteem, and gives us a sense of belonging to the whole world. Wow. You know, I just want to take my kids and get my grandkids, all everybody, and say, go outside. You should hold a church outside. You know, honestly, I've heard where your church, most people's church, is nature. You know, tell me if I was to ask you, where would you feel most nourished? I bet many of you would not say it's here. It's out there in nature. Except if you're listening to Judy and I, of course, you know, but do you know what I'm saying? We need it, see? So what can we do? How do we reconnect with this soul space? You know, how do we reconnect with who we really are? And it's what we talk about each week. It's about being able to be quiet enough to hear the beat of our own heart. It's about being quiet enough to breathe and hear yourself breathe, you know, and really breathe, to take it slow, you know, to take it, you know, one step at a time. It's about reconnecting, you know, with our heart. It's about remembering gratitude. You know, that's another thing. And it's about remembering, and I need to quit here, but I gotta say this. It's about remembering the cycles of life, you guys. It's about remembering that instead of demanding that we remain perpetual teenagers, I love this is what this lady said. You know, she says, instead of demanding that we remain in perpetual teenage mode, the preferred status of society, is that we allow ourselves to become truly initiated adults and elders that honors the natural pace of human life rather than fighting it, right? We fight this pace of human life. We don't want to get old, oh my gosh. You know, we don't want to see a wrinkle. We don't, you know, so we fight it. But when we look at how nature lives and we see the beauty in the cycles of life, that's how we get back to it. Doesn't mean that we don't put makeup on and try to, you know, do our best, but it means that we honor the cycles because we are part of life. And we're part of the cycle of life. You know, what I know is that, you know, we can make a few changes, just a few changes, and our whole life feels better because we do. We are vibrational beings. You know that the first word ever was OM. And that's why I love Terry's good plug for you, because that class that she does today, the gong, that's what it is. It vibrates. You vibrate with the sound of the universe, and that's what the gong does for you. You can do that going out to nature. You need to get back to who you are, this vibrational being that you are. What that means is that you just get in sync with nature until your heart starts to beat with nature. You make better decisions. You become smarter. Our true home is in the spirit. Remember that. Our true home is in the spirit. It's in the soul space. And once that we find it, we can feel at home wherever we are. Right? Once you find that soul space, wherever you go in the midst of all the chaos, you're home. You're home. My prayer for each of us is that we develop that. We develop that soul space so that we can get back to our roots in nature. My prayer is that we find our soul space and that we honor this beautiful, beautiful mother of ours, Mother Earth. Thank you.